The title Saudi Arabia in Transitions denotes a lot of things. I am a historian, not a political scientist, as some of my students had thought. But, I have tried to bring myself, and I've lived most of it, like you have. So it was just a matter of like, oh, now what date was that? And, and so forth. So I'm going to start with a little bit, a little bit of background. I'm used to teaching 18-year-olds and 19-year-olds who don't remember 2 weeks ago. So, if you were to ask them on a map, where is Saudi Arabia, they would not know. In fact, they don't even know. I was stunned. They didn't know we'd actually been in two or three wars. They completely did not know that. So anyway, if I get a little too basic, understand. But anyway, just a little geography, which I'm sure is, nothing surprising to anybody in this room, was just to get an idea of where Saudi Arabia is in the Middle East. And we'll get back to it later, but the centrality is very important. As far as being a nation state, there's geography and there's nationalism. It's the Arabian Peninsula, and it contains a lot of countries. But Saudi Arabia is, as we can see, occupies the largest part of that peninsula. And, is surrounded, by Persian Gulf, the Arabian Sea, and then the Red Sea. Over on its west side. And of course, I think most of us probably know that it's mostly desert. Doesn't have a whole lot of resources, except one. Historically, of course, its importance comes from religion, which, as we will see, plays an enormous part in its politics and everything else in the kingdom. The city there, right off the Red Sea, is the central location of the religion of Saudi Arabia, which is Islam, which was founded by the Prophet Muhammad in 622. If we have any Muslims here, forgive me. I mean, the way I'm going to address them easier as the Prophet or the Prophet Muhammad. There are certain styles, depending on where you come from. I mean no disrespect by that. For most of its existence, this area has been inhabited by different nomadic tribes. The primary, income was from raiding or from, later on, maybe some trading. And taxation of pilgrims as they came to Mecca. But anyway, that's kind of setting Saudi Arabia in its current position and its neighbors, Yemen, Oman, and the Persian Gulf states. And one area that really is of great concern to America is that it shares a border with Iraq. So that's very important. And you can see it's not very far either from Iran. Pet peeve of mine, I will tell you, just because I hear it mispronounced so often by broadcasters. It's Iran and Iraq, not Iran and Iraq, as we say here in Texas. It's Iran and Iraq. It's my pet peeve. We'll get to that. Okay, I want to zip through some other maps. Just again, this is giving you some of the cities in modern Arabia, which I'll come back to, and the oil, which we'll also come back to. But if we're talking about transitions, the greatest transition had to have been, of course, the creation of the Kingdom of Saudi Arabia. And it is a kingdom. It is an absolute monarchy, one of the few remaining absolute monarchies in the world. There is no democratic elected government. it is all ruled by one family, all the descendants of this man, whose long name, as you can see, is basically Abdulaziz Al-Saud is the short. In Middle East, he's known as Abdulaziz for short, and that's usually how I'll refer to him, or in the West as Ibn Saud. And he actually founded, his family had been an out of power as far as ruling the central city of Riyadh. So that's kind of like the historic base. And he had been in exile in Kuwait, and in 1902 he invades the kingdom and eventually captures Riyadh, and from there begins building alliances and, you know, especially to capture the kingdoms of Mecca and Medina. Now, as for the personality, and this is very important because it reflects a bit on the royal family that's governing Saudi Arabia, and it also reflects a little bit on the different cultural expectations and customs of the region. He could be diplomatic, or he could be very brutal. It just depended on the circumstance, you know. So, and cunning, and that's not something that we here in the West, particularly, you know, put much stock in. You know, we tend to see that as a very bad trait, but cunning is something that is admired, and strength is also admired among, I'll say generally, and there are always exceptions to generalizations, but strength among Arabs, and honor. It's an honor culture, very much so. So all these things, you know, and they're embodied, you know, of course, by the royal family. This area, the Najd, that is the area that contains Mecca and Medina, the two holy cities. Mecca is where, the Prophet Muhammad was born, and where he initially had his, you know, revelations. But because of conflicts, was forced to make the Hijra to Medina, where he found refuge. And that's really where the beginning of, I think, the Islamic calendar begins. But anyway, that is extremely important, that in Hijaz, because this is what gives the monarchy its absolute power. It would have to go back in our own minds to the Middle Ages, when the monarchy, the king, derived his power from the Pope, from religion. And so this is key, and this explains a lot of contradictions to us about Saudi policy and actions, is that he is styled, and all monarchs of Saudi Arabia are styled, guardians of the two holy cities. And so they have to simultaneously keep their bona fides, or bona fides, as Islamic leaders, and in order to keep their position and their authority. The minute they lose that, they lose control of the kingdom. And so, as we'll see, that'll be, as many observers would call it, a balancing act. They're always having to balance that need domestically, you know, with some of the outside pressures. Luckily for them, well, I say luckily, for the most part, they've been fairly isolated, and it's, as we'll see on that map with the cities, there aren't that many cities. So it's basically a lot, it's pretty isolated, easier to control, but that is changing, and we'll get to that. Anyway, he officially became the Kingdom of Saudi Arabia in 1932. And so it will be ruled by Ibn Saud. Now, what he, I won't say inherited, but what he created in terms of its economic foundations was pretty poor. And this was a problem because one of the ways that the Saudi royal family, even to this day, continue to hold power is by buying off, you know, if you know, support. It's a welfare state today. And of course, leaders of tribes were expected, you know, to share the wealth very much within the tribe, which was hard to do if you didn't have any money, which is why, and of course, this predates a little bit not much. The same year that he formed the Kingdom of Saudi Arabia, an oil company from California, a division of the great Standard Oil, SoCal, had in 1931 had actually gotten the concession to explore for oil, because another oil company had actually, from Bahrain, had found some oil, and so they made a deal. And it took a while, but finally in 1938, SoCal, you know, California, you know, Standard, struck oil, a gusher, near the city of Dhahran. I may have to go back a little bit. Is Dhahran on that map? It's in the east. I see Dhamman, but not Dhahran. Oh well. But it is, take my word for it, it's in the east, because that's where most of the oil is. And so that, of course, is going to be the future. But unfortunately, this was all interrupted by World War II. So it's going to take a while for the riches to begin pouring in. In fact, he was so, you know, poor during the war that he was having to take handouts from the British and the Americans to get by in the kingdom. You know, in America, the SoCal, which would later be renamed Aramco, the Arabian American Oil Company, was its facilities at Dhahran were bombed by the Axis power of Italy. So, you know, what little they had built there was gone. The president of the United States at the time, Franklin Roosevelt, had the vision to see that, well, you know, that oil was going to be important. And, you know, also that the kingdom itself was going to be important, you know, as a bridge between East and West. And so in 1943, Roosevelt, you know, gets his first toe in the water in Saudi Arabia by declaring that the kingdom is in danger from, because it's been bombed, you know, in danger and needs assistance, which opens it up to lend-lease aid so we can start sending military supplies. And then in 1944, we send our first resident diplomat. We had recognized Saudi Arabia as a country, but we'd always done business with them in Cairo, because Cairo's so much nicer, right? You know, so we send our first resident diplomat to Dhahran in 1944. But the pivotal event, and one that was recently, and for me, 2 or 3 years ago, was recently, you know, celebrated, was a meeting between President Roosevelt and Ibn Saud aboard the USS Quincy on Roosevelt's way back from Yalta. It stopped off in the Suez Canal in a lake. It's called the Great Bitter Lake. And Ibn Saud had traveled aboard another ship, and they met. Books have been written about the interesting things that happened, the cultural. There was only one guy on ship who could actually translate. He was also a cultural translator too, because the king actually brought with him herds of cattle and goat, because he didn't know what refrigeration was. And you know, stuff like that. And he brought his wives too, so couldn't have those aboard a destroyer. But out of this meeting comes a partnership that is one of the most enduring partnerships that America has had in the modern age. And that is what confounds some people, is how could two such profoundly different cultures, two such profoundly different governments sustain a relationship through all this. And one observer says it's because early on they determined, and in fact, you know, this is kind of the agreement, that our relationship would only extend to business. That basically the Saudis would rule their own house, so that we would never interfere domestically. And later on, that's actually put into writing with the State Department, I think in 51 or 53, that we would not interfere domestically within Saudi Arabia. And so that's allowed us to coexist, because believe me, we offend them in many of our ways as much as some of their ways can offend us. So, you know, we just agree to look past that and coexist. And so it's after the war, of course, that the oil and the oil facilities are developing. And also the military, because that's the second thing. And we have a couple of pillars of this relationship. Of course, one is oil, we know that. And the other is the military. And that changes a little bit in its focus over time. Initially, it was the Cold War. And so in 1951, the two nations signed a treaty, which really is the foundation of our military, our modern military relationship with Saudi Arabia, where we agreed to rebuild the bases. We have a permanent military training mission where we train the Saudis to build their own military forces, and also we agreed to sell them some armaments. So that's kind of the beginning. And also build an air base. And actually the building of the air base predates this. I got ahead of myself a little bit, because it predated the Air Force itself. Because we needed permission to fly over Saudi Arabia, and also, you know, because on the way, if we go back to, if we went to that map, as a way to get to Iran and to ultimately the Soviet Union during the war. So, you know, building an air base there, because recognizing the central role in the region. So let's see if we can't go back to that oil. Yeah. So there you can see, you know, and this is of course what interests, you know, so many of us here in Texas being in the oil business, is the oil reserves. It has some of the largest reserves right now that are being developed. Now, I've heard tell of some even larger reserves elsewhere, but they're not being developed. And look where they are. They're mainly in the eastern part. Now, they're on the Red Sea. Those are this refers to ethnic groups. The you know, the green part is the oil, or the dark part, and it's all in the east. And notice the yellow, because in the eastern part, we think of Saudi Arabia as because of Mecca and Medina, I suppose, and because they are primarily the royal family is Sunni. I haven't referred to that split yet, but anyway. There are a lot of Shiites who live in the oil-rich region of the east. And so, and it shares a border with Yemen. And of course, it's just across from Iran, which is probably how the Shiites got there in the first place. Because Iran is the only nation that is predominantly Shiite. All the other nations are Sunni. Now, if you don't understand what that means, I'll just briefly explain. When the Prophet Muhammad died, he had not named a successor. And so there was a disagreement among his followers as to who should succeed him. Some thought that his adopted nephew, Ali, if that's right, should succeed him because of his holiness and everything. But others were more practical. They thought that they needed a more experienced tribal leader, and they focused on a close friend of his, one who had been one of his scribes. By the way, the Prophet Muhammad was illiterate, and so when he received his revelations, he would have to dictate them to a scribe. And Abu Bakr, who became the first caliph, was one of these scribes. And so that was the beginning of the split. Those who chose to follow the first caliph, Abu Bakr, who was, that became the Sunni split in Islam. Those who thought that Ali should be the successor to the Prophet, they became the Shiites. Now, a lot of complications ensued after that, but that's basically it. Now, there are now, over the years, there had developed some theological differences. To us, they would seem minor, but what's minor to one person, not so minor to other. But anyway, we've seen, wars begun because of these splits. So even now, in the modern day, we'll talk about this, this Sunni-Shiite split, Iran and Saudi Arabia, that's a dicey relationship. But anyway, if you just, again, look at the map and where the oil is and where, who the predominant religious group is that lives there. And this might explain later on, right now, this was in the news this last week, and I know you people, unlike my students, watch the news. And you would have heard that a Navy SEAL was killed in military operations in where?
Yemen.
Exactly. Thank you. I wish I had you as students. And so we have been aiding in Saudi operations, Saudi-led, it is a coalition, Saudi-led operations in Yemen since 2015. And it has to do a lot with this Shiite-Sunni split, which, hopefully if my my timekeeper here, Stephanie, will remind me not to go on too long. I'll remind you of that. But anyway, next big transition, because we've kind of got our chess pieces in place. We've got the nation state, we've got the relationship with America, we've got the oil relationship, which was renegotiated because originally the Americans got most of the money, and I think in 1950, Ibn Saud said, unless you give us a better deal, we're going to kick you out. And so they, after that, got a 50-50 split. So, cunning negotiator. I want to go this way. When the king, the founder of this dynasty, and I'll say one more thing about this. In Saudi Arabia, they say his position is even greater than that of George Washington. It's huge, and it's that lineage that is so important, because he. It's not like the Pope. It's not quite like that. But here's a key thing that I think we really need to talk about, or mention. One key ally. We talked about how important it was to capture Mecca. One key ally in that. How are you going to get all these different tribes who were so used to fighting each other to pull together and fight with you? And the answer was religion. And he used a particular, we were calling him evangelist, fundamentalist Saudi cleric named Muhammad al-Wahhabi. And he taught that kind of like fundamentalists do this was a point that, whereas Christians say we should live the values that Jesus lived, but they don't say we should live physically like he did. To Muslims, they recognize that Muhammad was just a man, but in their religion, they try to copy how he lived in every way, how he ate, how he dressed, how he went through the day, all that. So that's one difference. But anyway, so that's what Muhammad, Wahhabi preached, is that we should go back to the time of the Prophet and his ways. There are four schools of law within Islam. And of course, his was the one he followed was the most conservative. And what made it special is that whereas all Islamists or all Muslims look to the Quran as the blueprint, this particular school, the Hanbali school, also looked to the sayings and stories of the Prophet, which were recorded in a book called the Hadith, the Sayings. And so some, like I said, some Muslims don't give that what we would call sacred value, but the Wahhabis do. And so this is how, and this is one of the biggest, you know, contrasts and conflicts that Americans have, or the West, with Saudi Arabia, is this ultra-fundamentalist religious. But Ibn Saud would have never ruled the kingdom without them. And so this is why, to this day, the kingdom continues to adhere to this ultra-fundamentalist Islamic creed, and to even fund its expansion throughout the Middle East. That's important very much to the continued. They have to, therefore, when the king speaks, it's basically, you know, it's you follow what he says absolutely, because there is a surah, and I don't know the exact quotation, but it's basically you follow your leader right or wrong, you know, and that's the backing, you know, of this religious sect. Okay, very quickly, I'm going to try to get up to the modern age. The immediate successor of Ibn Saud was his second son, also took the name King Saud. But King Saud, what can we say about him other than he was a little bit erratic? Look at the time frame, 1953. End of the Korean War, Dwight Eisenhower's just in the White House, change of policy, and more focus on the Middle East. And we always looked upon Saudi Arabia as a key component of that. But we had lots of problems with King Saud because he kept flipping, because it's also an age of Arab nationalism, Nasser in Egypt. And so for a while, King Saud is basically going to kick the American military out of Saudi Arabia, and he's going to align himself with the Arab nationalists. But then the Suez Crisis happens in 56. And surprisingly, Eisenhower stands up to Israel and France and Great Britain and defends Egypt. And suddenly Saud is like, oh, well, you guys can come back now. But then like 2 years later, when Egypt and Syria tried their experimented union, the United Arab Republic, Saud flips again. And he tells the Americans, you know, you can leave. But in 1962, Syria and Egypt invade Saudi Arabia. Again, reasons can be baffling. And so suddenly, having kicked his military advisors out, King Saud sends an SOS to President Kennedy and says, please, can you help me? And he says, oh, of course I can. And so he sends fighter jets flown by Americans and lots of military aid. And at that point, the royal family, and there is a council within the Al-Saud family which determines succession, which kind of, you know, puts their okay on who is the crown prince and so forth. There is today, anyway. They decide that, you know, maybe you better abdicate and let your half-brother Faisal take over as king. So in 1964, he was forced to step down, and Faisal becomes the king. Now, this is the king I remember growing up. And he's much more in tune with the Americans. You know, he allows Americans a much bigger presence in the kingdom because of his anti-communism. So he's a big ally in the Cold War. He also, we'll see this a little bit later, but, you know, began modernizing. And the Americans helped fund that. You know, corporations like Bechtel and others came in and helped, you know, build all these facilities, you know, for the Saudis. Refineries as well, you know, all the oil infrastructure that the kingdom needed. And so basically, throughout the rest of the 60s, our relations are pretty steady and, you know, not too conflicted until 1973, October 1973. We, the Americans, everybody was surprised when October the 20th, I think, the countries of Egypt and Syria and Jordan, they all invade Israel again. This is what we call the Yom Kippur War. In the Arabic countries, it's known as the October War. And for once, it looked like Israel might lose. And they would have if it hadn't been for Richard Nixon. Richard Nixon intervened by sending jets and fuel and other supplies and helped the Israelis fight back the Egyptians. And so America's direct intervention, I mean, our relationship with Israel was already a touchy spot, which, again, like a lot of things, is best ignored. But our direct intervention in this war was something that, as you know, the defenders of the holiest places in Islam, you know, could not take. And so he joined, and of course, by now, it was formed in the 60s, OPEC, the Organization of Petroleum Exporting Countries, announced an oil embargo, and he said, we're going to participate. And so against America and Europe. And so things, you know, took a bad turn for us then. You might remember, like I do, the oil embargo and everything that emanated from that. Also, this shouldn't be a surprise, not on terribly good terms with Nixon to begin with, because when Nixon became president, of course, all occupied with Vietnam, he said, we need to sort of, you've heard of the Nixon Doctrine. You know, when we've heard, and we know about how it was applied to Vietnam, that, you know, turned more of the fighting over to the Vietnamese and less from our troops. Well, how it was applied in the Middle East is, let the Saudis and the others take over more of their own defense, you know, and, you know, we'll just give them money or whatever. And so Nixon, the actual name for how the doctrine was applied in the Middle East was called the Twin Pillars Strategy. And this was another turning point in Middle Eastern history, because the twin pillars were Saudi Arabia and Iran. That's not great. But anyway, they were going to be proxies for us, you know, because that's what the oil was. I mean, in all things. I adhere to the, you know, the Watergate investigators. Follow the money, you know, follow the money. Follow the oil in the Middle East, as well as religion, if you want to have some understanding of their politics. So we had significant oil concessions in Iran as well. So we want, and Iran especially, because they share a border with the Soviet Union. So in terms of the Cold War, they were even more important to us sometimes than Saudi Arabia. And so we started, you know, the King Faisal actually lifted the embargo against us after only a year because we agreed to some concessions having to do with the Golan Heights. But anyway, and after that, we began signing these huge military deals with Saudi Arabia, sending them missiles and planes and you know, all sorts of money to fund that military so that they could, you know, act as our proxy in that region. know, do hopefully, I mean, we couldn't dictate, but we could, and this is the dance, somebody said it was a minuet, you know, we could suggest, you know, what they should do. Unfortunately, Faisal is not going to be a part of this for long because, as you can see, in 75, I remember this very much, he was assassinated by a nephew. I don't remember the reasons why. I just remember the kind of shock, you know, that, because it wasn't, you know, they received, it was like the old-fashioned levee. They received petitions, and they still do, petitions from ordinary Saudis, although they don't do it face-to-face anymore. It goes through bureaucratic channels. But he was assassinated by one of his nephews. And so I'm going to skip on ahead a little bit, because he was actually succeeded. Now, notice that all these guys are brothers or half-brothers. It's because Ibn Saud had 100 wives. Not at the same time. You know, because Islam allows you to have 4 wives at the same time, but he would often have them for only a little while. And a lot of his marriages were diplomatic, you know, to cement an alliance, you know, with one group or another. But the result was he had a lot of kids. I forget the exact number, but I think it was like 300. And amongst that, you know, there was like, you know, 40-something princes. So the succession goes from brother to brother to brother, you know, in order of age. It had gone to Faisal's next brother, Khalid. But Khalid had a stroke, as you can see here, and he's going to be succeeded by the crown prince, who was Fahd. So, you know, and eventually Fahd will become king in 1982. So even during the 70s, when Khalid was technically king, he was not the one making the decision. So that's kind of why I skipped over Khalid. It wasn't meant to disrespect him, but, you know, just because this is who's making the decisions. As, you know, this will happen. Actually, Fahd suffered the stroke, but King Khalid did have ill health, as I can see there. And so Fahd was ruling the country. Two things happened in this. Talking about transitions, I think of transitions as turning points. Maybe I'm using the word incorrectly, but two things happened in 1979 which are going to change the future of not just Saudi Arabia, but America. Okay. What happened in Afghanistan in 1979? Right, the Soviets. The Soviets invaded Afghanistan, which already had a communist government. In fact, that's why we were sending all this money and military, because we were funneling that money through the Saudis to what we would later call the Mujahideen, the people who were going to be fighting against the communists. And so, you know, the regime, and it was through that funding of the regime in Kabul was becoming unstable, and I'm giving a talk about this in another month, so I'll go into more detail. And so that's why the Soviets invaded, because they were, you know, afraid that it would be overthrown. So that's a key thing that happened in 79. And so we'll step up our assistance and funnel a lot of that through Saudi Arabia. Also Pakistan, which I'll also be talking about in a month. So that's why we're funneling all this money through them. But where the Saudi money goes also goes to religion. That also is key. So as a result of the Soviet invasion and occupation, there was a large exodus of many Afghanis into neighboring Pakistan, and, you know, a lot of the assistance, because it is the duty. There are 5 pillars of Islam, and one of which is zakat. You know, you have to give, they call it a tax, but you have to give it to charity. But they, you know, through education, and of course the Saudis are rolling in it, you know, in terms of money. And so these princes, and there are so many of them now because they're grandsons and great-grandsons, are giving this money to religious organizations who go out and, of course, set up schools for these Afghan refugee children, and they're teaching them Wahhabi Islam, which is not the kind of Islam they had back in Afghanistan. And we're going to see these guys coming back later as the Taliban. So just a little bit of foreshadowing there. But within Saudi Arabia, something that we hardly even know about here in the West, because that's the way they like it, you know, keep things opaque as much as possible. There was an assault on the center of Islam. A bunch of religious Wahhabist militants took over the Grand Mosque in Mecca and took hostages and demanded that the royal family step down because they were perceived as being too modern, too liberal. Now, I had a slide, which, there we go. There is the Great Mosque, huge. And of course, well, we'll talk more. But this young man at the top was the leader of the rebels on the ground, but they were followers of a particular Wahhabi cleric. And then they negotiated for about 2 months, the long siege. But ultimately, negotiation failed. And with the help, it's almost proving the case of the militants, with the help of the French, the Saudis go in and break the siege violently, you know, with bombing and with, I was very interested to read about this, with a particular kind of nerve gas, but not the kind that makes you die. It reminds me of laughing gas. It makes you feel real happy. But it also makes you very uncoordinated. And so basically, it knocked everybody out so that the military could come in and just pick up the rebels and herd them into a pen. You know, but they had to get to a certain point before they could do that. Now, thousands died, not just during the siege, but also in the executions that followed. Now, this puts the royal family in a dilemma because these militants are doing what they've been preached, you know, the Wahhabis, you know. So they can't be seen as being, you know, we have to be tough as rulers, so we have to execute these militants. But in the aftermath, very subtly, this is exactly what the Saudis do, they bend, you know. And so the royal family bent, they started becoming more conservative. And so they began issuing new religious laws. For example, before the 1979, they could have female presenters on TV. You know, they wore a headscarf, but they didn't have the full facial covering, and they didn't have to wear an abaya or anything like that. No more. No more women on TV. You know, other strict laws, you know. And so all of Saudi society becomes a lot more conservative, and they begin initiating religious classes in schools so that every boy after school, if you're Jewish, you know, you're Hebrew school, you know, in Saudi Arabia, it was, you know, Muslim, you know, you get your indoctrination. You don't have to go to the mosque. You get it right there at school. And the girls, of course, were taught the female version of this conservatism, which is if you want to get to heaven, it's you get married and you do exactly what your husband says, just like you would if the prophet himself said it, and that's your way to heaven. So not very good for modernism. And that's one of the things that was mentioned in the, you know, as I call it, the précis for this event. You know, was, you know, we disagree. Women's rights, you know, I'm a feminist, I admit it. A lot of guys are feminists too. Actually, I had a kid yesterday in class ask me, what is feminism? And I said, it just means that you want, you know, the same human rights as men. And then other women in the class began to clap, and I'm like, oh, okay, they know, they know. But anyway. So those two events, especially, you know, this seizure of the Grand Mosque, turned Saudi Arabia. I mean, they were beginning to modernize. They had universities. I mean, they weren't co-ed, you know, but they had universities, and you know, they had women, had a public presence, although, you know, they adhered by, you know, segregation. But talking, as some of the authors I read did, to Saudi women who lived through that, they said it became much worse after this, you know, where they could not go, they cannot go anywhere in society unless they are accompanied by a male. And this is, and I'll have to jump way ahead here, because the most recent king had tried to, he did make a woman a minister of education, but the only way she could communicate with others on the council was she had to be on Skype, basically, and they could not see her. They could only hear her voice. That's still, I mean, that's like, okay, one step forward, but three steps, you know, keep you know, still keep, they can't be seen. So that changed Saudi society radically for a long time. And it's out of that radicalism, you know, that we are going to get the 9/11 hijackers and the other jihadists. And these same jihadists, because they're criticizing the royal family, right? That was a major critique of those who invaded the mosque. So what to do? As any parent knows, redirect. You know, redirect that energy someplace else. Send them off to Afghanistan. Have them fight, you know, the infidel Soviet and, you know, atheistic communists there. And so young Saudi men, because there's a high unemployment rate among young Saudi men, because, well, they don't want to do the dirty work. But, you know, going on jihad, that is a straight path, you know, to heaven, as many of these clerics taught. And so, you know, even the Afghans talk about, you know, well, during the 70s, we fought the Soviets just fine. Oh, not the Soviets, the communists just fine. And in the beginning, we fought them. And then suddenly, these strange eras began showing up and kind of taking over and changing kind of the whole tilt. And their religious, you know, views and everything conflicted with those of the locals. But they began to found mosques, even in Afghanistan, the country, as well as in the refugee camps, teaching this Wahhabist version of Islam, this fundamentalist Islam, which is foreign to the old Afghanistan. So those 79, very big turning point. Let's see. I'd like to jump straight to 9/11, but there's just a few things probably in between. Yeah, in 1982, we've already said that King Fahd succeeds to the throne. As far as oil goes, in 1988, King Fahd issued a decree basically nationalizing Aramco, that it would no longer be any split with the Americans, that the Saudis were going to take over the management and the production and everything. And so after that, all of the oil and all of the revenues go to the Saudis. So we still have Americans over there, and we still have, you know, oil interests, you know, but Aramco, and it's called now Saudi Aramco, just to distinguish it from its predecessor. But Saudi Aramco, strangely enough, because there are many Americans still employed, they have their own little compound in Saudi, and they say it's like a military base overseas. It's like a little America. You know, the rules don't apply there. Women can go, you know, just like we do in America, in shorts and, you know, no head coverings, and the same thing, nothing applied to the Saudis. So a Saudi woman, an engineer, can go into the Saudi Aramco base, operate just as we would, you know, in no segregation, you know, completely uncovered, but the minute she leaves those gates, back on, you know. And so, you know, it's just this bizarre contrast. And so, you know, a lot of people, if they can, they want to get a job at Saudi Aramco because, you know, life is much easier. But anyway, that's just, you know, keep, since oil was one of our pillars of our relationship, I just wanted to mention that out. Okay, excuse me, I knew I was going to trip on that. Let's see what event I want to do next. So we're supporting the anti-communist regime in Afghanistan, and we know eventually that, you know, the Soviets are going to abandon that. But something happens about the same time as that is going on, and that is in 1990. And let me go back to my maps here. There we go. That little country to the north, Iraq, and its leader, Saddam Hussein, invade, and it's not labeled, but that little, you know, triangle there at the end is the country of Kuwait. And Saddam invaded Kuwait in August of 1990. And immediately, by this time, are we still on FOD? I think we are. Yeah, and he declares a war on Saddam Hussein and immediately turns to the Americans and says, hey guys, you know, you want to get in on this. Basically, the religious council, there are 20 of the ulama, the official ulama, basically do whatever the king wants. And so he says, I want you to say it's okay for these infidels to come in with their guns and with their females and whatever, and set up, you know, these military, because we need our oil, their oil, needs protection, because we think that that's what Saddam wants next. You know, once he's nationalized, once he's taken over Kuwait, you can see it's just a very short step to those oil fields in eastern Saudi Arabia. So that's called Operation Desert Shield. And that was about 100,000 American soldiers. And then, of course, all this time, our president, George H.W. Bush, is assembling an alliance. He goes to the UN and he makes an alliance with Britain and France and Spain and all these other countries. And so eventually they all send their soldiers too, to the kingdom, all in preparation for what we know is coming, which is the invasion of Kuwait. Which happens February the 22nd of 1991. After a month of bombing, we bombed a lot to make Saddam, you know, think that we were going to invade elsewhere. But and then it took 4 days before, you know, it wasn't a surrender so much as, you know, we were halfway to Baghdad when the president said stop. You know, and the reason was, you know, because the removal of Saddam would give us what we have today, which is chaos. So they negotiated that. But it was that, the presence. And we kept a token force of 5,000 Americans there in the kingdom just in case. And it's just as they cited the liberality of the ruling family as a reason for invading the mosque, you know, so too are the 9/11 hijackers. When Osama bin Laden, he had been a mujahid in Afghanistan. He had, although, even though he was pictured holding an AK-47, he really didn't. He was more of a funder than a fighter. And he actually tried. He went through channels, you know, and appealed to the royal family. Look, this violates, you know, the kingdom, you know, and defiles, you know, Islam everywhere. And in the holy, you know, guardians of Mecca and Medina, get these infidels out of here. And, you know, but the royal family need America, and so that's not gonna happen. And so eventually, Osama gets kicked out. He takes jihad on the road, which is unfortunate for us. So, you know, you see, the original, again, a bit of redirection. The focus keeps coming back where? To the center, to the royal family. And when that happened, the Saudi strategy is redirect. So the Saudi, there was an investigation following 9/11, and we could never prove any direct relationship between the bombings and the government. But there was a lot, you know, the way the money passed, you know, through different religious charities and different agencies and everything, very opaque. You know, we didn't, in fact, later they did, you know, find out that unbeknownst to them that some of the Persian Gulf states had funneled money that ended up funding the hijackers. But, you know, some of this money was helping to fund these radicals. And so it was, and this is a date we all remember. Where were you on September 11th, 2001? And that was when four planes were hijacked by 12 men. Three of them hit their targets, which were the Twin Towers in New York, and one was the Pentagon. The fourth one, we don't know. We suspect either the Capitol or the White House, but it was taken over by, that was Flight 83, and American Airlines 83, and crashed in Shanksville, Pennsylvania. Another turning point, because we did, the government actually did cover it up, but nobody ever made a big deal about this. Yeah, because right now there's a big hullabaloo about immigrants and Muslims and all that. But we conspired to take members of the bin Laden family that were here in the U.S. and fly them out. When there was an air ban and no planes were flying, we flew them out, you know, because that's part of that alliance. And I forget, most, I think, eight or nine of the hijackers themselves were from Saudi Arabia, who were our allies, you know. But if we look, and I'm just jumping straight ahead here to the very present day, which I don't like doing, but you know, if you look at the countries that are on ban list, Saudi Arabia ain't on it, you know, and that's where most of the terrorists came from. That's where most of the money came from, and it's because of this alliance. So, you know, the Saudis had to tread very lightly, and you know, and we began to really, we Americans finally began to ask questions and demand more transparency. You know, if you're going to be our ally, then why are you funding these people who want to kill us? And if it hadn't been for something that happened a couple of years later, things might not have changed. But in 2003, you know, once again, there was an attempt to take over. Actually, no, excuse me, I'm getting confused. In 2003, the bombing of the Khobar Towers, you'll remember that possibly as well, where a lot of American servicemen had apartments. And there were other attacks as well against Saudi targets. So once again, it's kind of come back to the center, back to Saudi. Despite their best efforts to, you know, kind of redirect it. And that's when, by now we've moved on to Crown Prince. Fahd, by now, has had his stroke. And in 92, I think it was, that Abdullah became basically the ruler in everything but name. Crackdown on Al-Qaeda, on militants, on conservative, and began a swing back away from conservatism toward modernization. So looking at Saudi Arabia for the most part today, a lot of its modernization, such as it is, and we've got to give some credit where credit is due, comes from, I'm going to call him King Abdullah, because he did eventually become king. And he only recently passed away in 2015, which is just yesterday, right? He made a university, a co-ed university, well, segregated within the classrooms, of course. King Abdullah Science, you know, we call it CASC, but it's in Riyadh, and it's the first university that has both men and women. And of course, there's a big emphasis, not surprisingly, on math and science, engineering, you know, for working in the oil fields, because you don't get a lot of the liberal arts, because they don't want people questioning philosophy. Those things are not, social sciences are not encouraged. He also was more liberal on the issue. When we say liberal, this is by Saudi standards, liberal on the issue of women. It was in 2005 that he said eventually Saudi women will be able to vote for local municipal councils. You know, it doesn't sound like much. And those councils, they said, are basically toothless. But in 2012, it happened. They got to vote. They came out and they voted. And some of them even got elected to those councils. But just like that Minister of Education later on, I think she was appointed like in 2014, they had to communicate from a separate location. They could not even be in the same room as the male counselors, you know. So one step forward, two steps back, but if you want to call that. But, you know, that's their compromise, their way of stepping forward. So it's always this delicate balance between, you know, modernization and conservatism. Now, very quickly, you know, because I did mention Yemen, the conflict there has to do with the Arab Spring, which, you know, we saw in Egypt, we saw in Tunisia and Libya, Algeria, Syria, and Bahrain, some of the Gulf states, Saudi Arabia intervened there, and in Yemen. In fact, there's a large number of Shiites in Yemen. They're called Houthis. And they actually overthrew the king, who was an ally of Saudi Arabia, who was a Sunni. And today, to this day, they have a government, which we don't recognize, in the capital of Sana'a. We, the Americans, and the Saudis, and a big alliance are supporting the ousted royal family and their Sunni alliance. And so basically there's civil war in Yemen, and we are a part of it. Now, go out on the street and ask most Americans, first of all, you ever heard of Yemen? You know, where is it? And did you know that we're involved, that we are sending money and armaments and troops to this civil war? And they say, never heard of it, but we are. And of course, within Saudi Arabia, it's a big source of frustration because they haven't won, you know. And again, as a historian, I'm not into predictions. I'll leave that to the political scientists. But, you know, one of the things that the Price said, you know, about the future, you know, what do we see coming for the future? You know, this is something that I see as a threat to the royal family, because the deputy crown prince, who is the son of the current king, not the brother, we've run out. I mean, they're all old. I mean, let's face it. You know, it's been a long time. So, you know, we have a crown prince, but what's happened is that the current king has stepped over that crown prince and made his son, who's only 31, the defense minister and all this other stuff, and he is in charge of this war in Yemen. And he has no military experience, unlike his older, you know, the crown prince. And so, all the younger Saudis like this young guy. He speaks their language. He plays the media. He does the internet. He does social media and all that. And so that might be, you know, kind of, you know, the next crisis to come might be some internal, you know, Saudi unrest over this war in Yemen. But my prediction is that, like all the previous storms, the royal family will come through this one just fine, that they will bend and they will make concessions, and everything will stay the same. And our relationship, of course, with Saudi Arabia, because they are our partners in fighting Al-Qaeda. and in fighting ISIS. So the war on terror has taken over from the war, Cold War, but you know, they're still our partners. So as long as we have these pillars, oil and the military alliance, then I think that whatever differences we have socially, you know, feminism, modernism, et cetera, you know, will always take a back seat. So I could talk forever, you know, but I don't want to, and you don't want me to. So that's as much as I'll say.